All right, today is Wednesday, February the 8th. This is AP Chemistry. Today we're going to be talking about KSP problems. We've already talked about how to solve two different types of KSP problems. The two types of problems are calculate the molar solubility given the KSP. And that was just where we go when we use X and X, or if it happened to be like a PbCl2, PbI2. Okay, let's focus now. Like PbI2 breaks up into PbI2 plus and 2I minus. So if we were doing this type of problem, it'd be X and 2X. But the X plays twice, so it's going to be 2X squared. Okay, now, I do note today that we are not kind of sitting, because we have the 29 today, not the 33, that some of us have adjusted. But if we can't control ourselves in that adjustment, we're going to go back to where we're supposed to be, okay? Because we need to focus today. Today, the three problems we're going to do today are pretty challenging. So we want to make sure that we they're just keeping the steps straight. They're not long. They're just making sure we recognize the type and remember how to do them. So we need to pay attention. But we have our two. So we have the molar solubility, and we have, given the solubility, we calculate KSP. They're just the two reverse type problems. Okay? And we did practice of each one of those in class, including, I think, the 2010 AP problem. We looked at least the first part of it. Everywhere I go, you're looking around me. I keep trying to move. Okay? So we want to go to our third type of problem, which is going to be called a common ion problem. This is where you're going to try to dissolve a salt, not into pure water, but into a solution that contains one of the two ions you're trying to dissolve. It's called a common ion problem. And then when we get to acids and bases, it's going to be a special type of common ion. It's going to be called a buffer. And that's the really fun one. That's the very last thing that we'll be doing this year, so that'll be at the end of March. Something to look forward to. So number three is going to be called a common ion problem. Dissolving a salt into a solution that contains one of the ions all caps in red, always lowers the solubility. So you'll always be able to dissolve less if the solution already contains some of the ion. For example, we would say, what is the solubility, let's just say molar solubility, of CaF2 in pure water? The KSP of CaF2 is given to you as 4.0 times 10 to the minus 11. I'm getting ready for the faculty student basketball game. They have said that I've been playing. I haven't played in the past 2 years, mainly due to my shoulder always being operated on. Most of the time I've been relegated to being a coach, put on the bench. I will not be starting, I guarantee, and I won't play for much more than 2 minutes, because then I'll be sucking eggs. And that 94 feet gets really long really fast. And the problem with the teacher team is that the teachers keep, we're getting older and fatter and slower every year, but we're constantly playing the same aged kids, because it's always 16 to 18 year olds that are in shape and can run. But so at some point, we're going to lose, but it hasn't been to this point yet. We have never lost.
Well, if you have Gabriel, that's
yeah. He still runs marathons. He's incredible. All right. I can't drive 26 miles without stopping to get something to drink or, you know. Yeah, he bikes to school. Anyway. All right. So, what's the first thing we need to do to solve just this part? Okay, what? Hey, refocus now. Jen, here we go. What do we have to do just to solve this? What's the first thing we probably ought to write, do? Write the equation. So the calcium fluoride solid, when you go to dissolve it, what's it going to dissociate into?
Calcium
2 plus.
2 plus.
2 F minus. Plus 2 F minus. Okay? Now, we know it's 2 plus. We can figure that out. First off, we know that the fluoride is minus 1 based upon the fact that it's a halogen. Or we can just look up and see that calcium is a plus 2 because it's an alkaline earth metal. Okay, but these are ionic compounds, so they dissociate into ions, so the charges are very, very, very important, mandatory, not assumed to be there. Okay, you must write them. So, Ca breaks up into Ca2 plus and 2F minus. So the Ksp expression is going to be what? Ksp expression. It's just F minus, whatever the F minus. Now, the F minus is going to be double whatever the calcium is, but we don't write the 2 in there. Okay, it's just F minus concentration, but if we were to put X in 2X, then it's going, which we're going to have to do, we're going to have to then, because the F is going to be twice the concentration of the Ca. So we know now, am I allowed to erase this now? That breeze feels so good. God, I make one comment and I lose y'all. All right, so the Ksp is given as 4.0 times 10 to the minus 11th. That's going to equal, we don't know how much we're calculating the molar solubility, so we're trying to calculate how much actually dissolves. So that means it's going to be X, and whatever the calcium is, the fluoride is going to be double that, so it's going to be 2X, but because of our equilibrium expression, it's squared, so the 2 plays twice. So that's going to all equal what? 4x, not squared, cubed. That's a big difference. Okay? Now, y'all listen. So we divide by 4. So that's going to be 1 times 10 to the minus 11th. Then take the cube root of that. The cube root of 1 is 1. The cube root of 10 to the minus 11th, no, it's not, probably not going to come out to 1 because it's 10 to the minus 11. So what's that come out to? 2.2 times 10 to the minus 4th is equal to X, which is equal to my Ca2 plus concentration, which is really how much CaF2 dissolved. Because for every one of these, one of those dissolved. Okay? So when we say the molar solubility, it's always going to be of this thing. It's saying this. That's how much of this dissolved. Now, it dissolved as this and this, but it's always going to be of the left side. So that's how much dissolves in pure water. But what does the whole idea of Ksp mean? I always say what?
You always say something that you
want to Yeah, so right when you think you can understand it, then I have to go and throw in the curveball, throw the wrench into the works. What does this expression mean? Ksp is equal to this, is equal to 4 times 10 to the minus 11. How much of this, these two ions can be together? It's the solubility product. The product of these two ions cannot exceed this. Anything that exceeds this is going to precipitate out and form a solid. This is the maximum amount that can be dissolved. So what happens if instead of putting in the pure water, now I put it into a solution of sodium fluoride? If I put it into a solution of sodium fluoride, what's the common ion? Fluoride, right? So now I'm going to have some of this. So if this number is already bigger, what's that going to mean about this number if it can only equal this number? It's got to be smaller. Because we already have some fluoride from a second source, from the sodium fluoride, that means that we can't have as much calcium because the fluoride ion concentration is always going to be greater. Yes. Okay? So, for B, what is the solubility, the molar solubility of CaF2 in a solution that is .025 molar NaF? So if it's 0.025 molar in NaF, what's the Na plus ion concentration going to be? Say it. You guys are whispering it. Just say it. You both are right. Whoever, I'm hearing the whispers. What's the Na plus concentration going to be in a solution of 0.025 NaF? 0.025. What's the F minus concentration going to be? 0.025. Okay, which one are we, what's the common ion? The fluoride. So we don't need to worry about the sodium at all, but we know now that we have 0.025 molar sodium, 0.025 F minus, but the F minus, so we're still going to be, we want the molar solubility of this. So we still are looking at this equilibrium. But this time, we're putting it not into pure water, so our initial concentrations aren't 0 and 0. This time my initial concentration is 0 and 0.025. This is from the NaF. Okay, and I probably ought to write that in a different color to make it stand out. Okay? So the 0.025 initially is from the NaF, but we're trying to dissolve this into a solution, so we have a common ion. So now we're still going to get our change is going to be X and 2X. So at equilibrium now, we're going to have X amount of this, but we're going to have 2X plus 0.025. Now, we have two ways we can solve this. We can use our fancy calculators and just plug it in, and we can say that this KSP is still the same, 4.0 times 10 to the minus 11th is equal to X times 2x plus 0.025, and that's going to be squared. So you can just plug it into your fancy calculator and do that. But we don't all have a fancy calculator, and sometimes that math gets to be just a pain. We can make the math easier. For the first time in all in 2 years of chemistry, sig figs are going to be our friend. Okay? Because we know that this KSP is so small that the amount of calcium fluoride that's actually going to dissolve, the value of X, is going to be very tiny. So much so that to 3 or 4 sig figs, the 0.025 plus 2X is still going to equal 0.025. So we can make that assumption. We can say that we assume that 0.025 plus 2X approximately equals 0.025. Okay? So that means we can just ignore the 2x. Now that makes the math really simple. So now you just ignore this 2x, so it's just going to be 4.0 is equal to x times 0.025 squared, divide that in, x equals. Now, you can validate this by using your fancy calculator, your Inspire calculator, and put the whole thing in and see how the assumption compares to the real answer. Okay? But so if you just have a TI-30, okay, TI-30, And we were talking about the calculator. I actually went and looked up an image and looked up some of the history. Mr. Graber was coming in. He saw my calculator. The SR40 that I got, the first handheld calculator that was this size that was affordable, under $20. The first ones came out were like $400 and something dollars. But it wasn't until the late 70s that they came out handheld. I saw my SR40, and then it turned into the TI-30. So thinking about buying one just as a souvenir. But there was one, too. It was trying to sell for $200 on the Internet. Okay, so what do we get for X? X equals Ca2 plus, which is equal to my actually CaF2 concentration. What does that equal? You can either do solve, or you can just go 4.0 times 10 to the minus 11 divided by 0.025 squared. 6.4 times 10 to the minus 9th molar. Now, did you do that with the assumption or with the solve function?
Assumption.
Did anybody put in their Inspire and do the solve function? Okay, I need somebody to verify since Reese is... Okay, so minus 8, 6.4 times 10 to the minus 8. Okay? Now, did anybody do it with the Inspire? Somebody put it in their Inspire and do it with the solve function. That's a TI-30, isn't it? Yeah, so that's just with the assumption. I want it with using the 2X. Oh, Andy, you're calculating what you get. Same thing? Okay? Y'all don't know how to use your calculators for taking this long. Okay. Emma got the same answer putting it in her calculator using the 2X. Okay? Both. You get the same answer either way. Emma did use the 2X. She used the solve function on her calculator. Okay? Yes? Plexico finally, somebody finally got it on your calculator? All right. Alright, so here, listen. Here's the rule. Listen, I need to see some eyeballs. As long as the value of K is 1,000 times smaller than the concentration. This concentration is 2.5 times 10 to the minus 2. We're at 10 to the minus 11 for the value of KSP. As long as you're a factor of 10 to the third difference, 1,000 difference between those two numbers, you can make that assumption that X is negligible. On those equilibrium problems we did at the beginning, it wasn't that much difference, and so we couldn't make those assumptions, so we had to go in and we had to use the solve function on our calculator. But with these type problems, they're almost always going to be, you're going to be able to make the assumption. So really, a common ion problem is simpler. But notice what happened to the solubility. Here, in pure water, the solubility is equal to 2.2 times 10 to the minus 4th molar. Now, that's still not very soluble. Okay? That's 0.00022 molar. Okay? Anything less than 0.1 molar is what we call a precipitate. So you put this into solution, calcium fluoride, not very much of it's going to dissolve. Most of it, anything you put in there is just going to sit on the bottle. The little bit that does dissolve is going to be in there, and then this is the maximum that can be together. But if you try to put it into a solution of sodium fluoride, then all of a sudden the solubility drops down to 6.4 times 10 to the minus 8th molar. That's a factor of 10 to the 4th less. That's 10,000 times less soluble when it's in a common ion. So if you need to precipitate an ion out of solution, you want to get all of it out, you can always just add in a common ion. And that common ion, the more this value, where are we at here? The more this value goes up, the smaller this value is going to be. So the more common ion you add in, the less of the CaF2 that's actually going to be able to dissolve. Adding a common ion always lowers the solubility of the ion because it's a product. If one goes up, the other has to go down because it's going to equal a constant. Does that make sense? Okay. So, let's just, you practice one. Example two. What is the molar solubility of, let's pick one, an insoluble solid. Okay, hey Reese, aren't we supposed to not just talk out at will in class? Okay, aren't we supposed to be copying this down and doing the sample problem? Okay. So he's just screaming out in class. Hey, whatever, you know, I'm right in the middle of talking. Okay, you turn to page 1126. And unfortunately, we don't have magnesium phosphate in there. Where's my phone? Okay, somebody look up on your phone. Look up, ask Siri, what is the KSP value for magnesium phosphate? What is the KSP? Do we get a value? Times 10 to the minus what? 13th? Okay. All right. So, that's always going to be given. Now, so this is A. This is pure water. But then we say in a solution of 0.010 molar sodium phosphate. Okay, so calculate now both the molar solubility in pure water and in a 0.010 molar sodium phosphate. Yeah, I mean, that's one of the ones that's common one. We should know what phosphate is at this point. Remember, we memorized ions at one point. That's what we did memorize, okay? That's why we're going to keep going. That's why we're using them. Okay? Okay. So, in this section, it's going to be a good thing. It's just every time we use an ion to just kind of keep repeating it, keep doing it. Okay? Because we need to know those ions. And when we write the formula of an ion, what's the first thing that we have to do? Phosphorus is in which family? Look where phosphorus is. It's in that 15, right? Okay, it's with nitrogen and phosphorus. So what's the charge going to be on all those ions? -3. We don't have the, so those are all -3. The oxygen families are all minus what? 2. Halogens are all? 1. No, the red light means it's recording.
The flashing red light means
how do we do it on here?
Okay, the only way to do it on here is to assume that 2x is negligible. Okay? So that means it's just going to be the 4.0 times 10 to the minus 11 divided by 0.025 squared.
No.
Okay. Yeah, and yeah, you didn't need that parenthesis.
Hey, Hobbs, I saw you at the game.
Yeah. I was going to, after the first half, after you got that solid 9 seconds in.
Yeah.
You know, but then you guys got some good playing time at the end once the game was out of control, and you know, and they, you know.
Why
were
we talking about breaking up?
No, 3-2 to 27.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We're not?
Why were we talking about charging?
Because somebody was asking what the charge of phosphate was. But it's going to be the same as if it was phosphide. Whatever the non-metal is, that's going to be the charge on the polyatomic ion. So anything with sulfur in it is going to be minus 2. Anything with selenium in it is going to be minus 2. Anything with... No. But the charge is necessary for the problem of the phosphate. But again, so we don't have to memorize the actual charges. You can figure out the charge on the polyatomic ion by where the nonmetal is on the periodic table. All you have to memorize is how many oxygens there are. You can balance the charge. Because, so first off, we know that magnesium is plus 2 and phosphate is minus 3. So what's the formula for magnesium phosphate? Right? So we're going to go to, what's it going to break up into? 3Mg, two pluses, plus 2PO4, three minuses. Correct? So now my KSP, which is equal to 2.5. Mg2 plus raised to what power? To the third, whatever the coefficient is. And then the PO4 2 minus, 3 minus, is to the 2. Okay? So now, we're saying in pure water, so our initial is 0 and 0. But when it breaks up, the change is going to be, since here and here, what's the relationship between this? 3 to 2. So we could theoretically let this be x, and this be 3 halves x, but it's easier just to say that this is going to be plus 3x, and this is going to be plus 2x. Just to get the right ratio. So then 2.5 times 10 to the minus 13th is going to equal 3x cubed times 2x squared. Okay? Now, we can still do this with your simple calculator. What does this come out to? 108 times x to the fifth. Right? There's going to be 3 times 3 times 3 is 27 times 4. Okay? So it's going to be 3 cubed, which is 27, times 2 squared, which is 4. So 27 times 4 is 108. Then you add your exponents for your x's. So now how do I, does everybody know how to use your y to the x button or know how to use that little caret button on how to take the fifth root on your calculator? Okay? So if you don't know how to do the fifth root, now's a good time to learn. So it's going to be 2.5 times 10 to the minus 13th divided by 108. And then we're going to take the fifth root of that to equal x. Yeah, so yeah, now everyone's using their Inspire calculator on this one. No. 2.8 times 10 to the negative third. How did I wasn't even close. 1.18, right? Times 10 to the minus 3. So, is that my molar solubility? Yeah, if this is X, right? X is the amount that dissolves. You're going to get 3X of that and 2X of that. So this X is this. If I wanted the Mg2+ concentration, multiply this by 3. If I want the phosphate, multiply it by 2. But this is my concentration of Mg3PO42. Okay? So that's in pure water. But now calculate it in terms of a solution of sodium phosphate. So, to do B, somebody tell me. Okay, I'm going to use the same KSP expression. 2.5 times 10 to the minus 13. But this time it's going to equal what? What's my common ion going to be in a solution of sodium phosphate? The phosphate, right? So this is still going to be what? 3x cubed. But now this one's going to be, what do I put for the phosphate?
2x plus 0.01.
And that's going to be squared. But what can I assume? 2x is, and you write that out to the side. You say assume 2x plus 0.010 approximately equals 0.010. And then you just plug it in and solve for this. So 3x cubed is equal to, divide that by 10 to the minus 4, so it's going to be 2.5 times 10 to the minus 9. Divide that by 27, take the cube root of it. Is everybody following the math? Oh, and by the way, I had a little bit of an epiphany. Every Monday for the rest of the semester, for the rest of the year, till May, we're going to be taking 12 by 12 multiple choice, multiplication table test without a calculator.
Yay!
It's going to be timed. And we're going to do addition. So it's going to be a 1 through 12 addition table where it's but it's not going to be in order. Do what? Okay, so in other words, you have to be it. Y'all. No, this is not third grade. This is, y'all's completion grades are already super high this 9 weeks. Now. Now listen, this is to help you on the no calculator math part. It's just being able to know that 8 plus 5 equals 13. Some of y'all are going to be, you know. And then, who knows, maybe we'll, as the weeks go on, we might throw in some negative numbers or even some fractions. All right, so. Yeah, and I bet there's 25 to 50% missed it because you didn't have a calculator. Some of y'all probably put 17. All right. So what does this come out to? Some of you are saying, oh, crap, what'd I put?
Mr. Hobbs, we can't ignore 2x, can we?
Yeah, because this concentration right here is way smaller, way bigger,
so
this.
It's not the molar solubility.
It's this compared to this.
So it's not that. It's not the lubricating.
No. But I mean, you can plug it into your Inspire and see it comes out the same, doesn't it? Okay. So x is equal to my concentration of Mg3, which is equal to what value? What's the answer?
I got 4.3.
Times 10 to the negative 4. Okay? So again, note that we went down by a factor of 10 for your concentration. Okay? The molar solubility decreased because of the common ion. So concept number one is anytime you try to dissolve a substance, a salt, into a solution that contains the common ion, the solubility is always reduced. So the solubility in this case, the phosphate, is coming from two sources. The phosphate is coming from the magnesium phosphate, that's just how much we're trying to dissolve, plus it's coming from the sodium phosphate that was already there.
Why is it 2.5 times 10 to the negative 9?
Because I divided by 0.01 squared, which is 10 to the minus 4. Okay, so that's our third type of problem. It's called a common ion problem. All right? So now we're going to look at problem number 4. Problem number 4 is, will a precipitate form? All right, hey, y'all, we're just kind of going crazy here. So this is, will a precipitate form? So we're going to mix two things together. So if I put some silver nitrate and some sodium chloride together at certain concentrations, will a precipitate form? Now, the reality is that this is a two-pronged problem. It is a Q problem. These are Q problems. Even though it's never going to mention that it's a Q problem. So if Q is greater than Ksp, so in other words, if the concentrations that aren't in equilibrium are greater than Ksp, what do you think is going to happen? If Q is greater than Ksp, a precipitate will form. Okay, so that's really the crux of the problem right there, is we solve for Q and then compare it to the given Ksp. Just like kind of like we did in Q problems, is the system at equilibrium? Okay, if there's no precipitate form, then it's not at equilibrium, and so it's going to, there's no precipitable form. But the second prong of this problem is that when you mix solutions together, they're going to dilute each other, just like we kind of did in our kinetics lab, where we mixed A plus B plus D, and they all diluted each other, so we had to get the actual concentration once they were all mixed together. So this is also, these are also dilution problems. Because when we get our concentration of the ions that we're going to plug into our Q or our Ksp expression, we have to have the diluted concentration, because that's actually what it's going to be trying to mix together. That's going to be the solubility product. So these are dilution problems, and I really meant to say these are also dilution problems. Okay, so we got to do two things. First off, we have to find what the diluted concentration is. Then we plug it into our Ks. Well, it's just like Ksp, but we're going to do Qsp, and then compare if Q is greater than K, a precipitate will form. If not, no precipitate will form. So an example problem. Will a precipitate form when 10 milliliters of 0.010 molar silver nitrate is mixed with 5 milliliters of 0.0025 molar CaCl2. Now, what precipitate would be the precipitate here? If you put silver nitrate with calcium chloride, what would the precipitate be? Silver chloride, right? So that's the Ksp that we're dealing with, because whatever the precipitate is, we're not worried about the calcium chloride or the silver nitrate per se as far as the Ksp or setting up that equilibrium. It's all about what the precipitate's going to be. So we need the Ksp of silver chloride, which is equal to 1.8 times 10 to the minus 10. Now you get that from the back of the book. That's always going to be given in the problem. Okay? So the first thing we want to do, and I'm going to come over here, so I'm up high and you guys aren't ducking around the iPad. So I'm going to have AgCl breaking up into Ag plus and Cl minus. So Ksp is equal to 1.8 times 10 to the minus 10th. Ag plus times Cl minus. Okay? Now, and that's also going to equal Qsp. So what I have to do is I have to find Q and compare it to my given K. So I got to see it. Are my concentrations of these two things, if I multiply them together, once I mix the solutions together, are these two concentrations going to be greater than this number? If they are, precipitate forms. If not, no precipitate forms. I have no idea. I just made the numbers up. So let's just see. So what I need to do is I need to get my silver ion concentration. Okay? So my silver ion, the AgNO3, is going to break up into Ag plus, plus NO3 minus, right? So I'm starting off with 10 milliliters of 0.01 molar. But how much am I going to? What am I mixing that with? 5. So what's my total volume going to be? 15. So what's going to happen to the silver nitrate concentration? It's going to go down, right? It's getting diluted. How much is it getting diluted by? What ratio? 10 to 15, right? It's going to go from 10 to 15, which means it's going to be two-thirds as concentrated as it was before. So my silver concentration, since it's 1 to 1, my silver concentration is going to equal 10 milliliters over 15 milliliters. Now, well, let me just even do this just so you can see. What's the equation for dilution? MCVC is equal to MDVD, right? That's your formula. Anytime we have a dilution problem, that's the formula you're going to use. Molarity of the concentrate times the volume of the concentrate equals molarity dilute times volume of dilute. I had to use that today in making up acetic acid solution for the lab tomorrow. Okay, 17.4 molar is what the concentrate is. I need 500 milliliters of 1 molar. So 17.4 times what volume of the acetic acid did I need? Okay, that's what I was looking for, is equal to the molarity of the dilute, which was 1 molar, and I wanted to make 500 milliliters of it. So it's basically 500 divided by 17.4, and I found that it was 28 point something milliliters that I needed to make the 1 molar acetic acid. Okay? 17.4 is as concentrated as you can get. It's called glacial acetic acid. That's what how you buy it, in the most concentrated form. The acetic acid probably wouldn't, because it's a weak acid, but it's still not going to be good for you to get on you. You left it on there for any amount of time, it's going to burn you, yeah. Okay? Now, but for this one, we want the molarity of the dilute. So we're going to divide by the volume of the dilute, right? So notice we're going to get the volume of the concentrated, which is 10. It's always going to be this. 10 divided by the volume of the dilute is going to be 15. So it's 10 15ths times the original concentration. Okay? So that's what we were setting it up. So the molarity of the dilute is just going to equal 10 milliliters divided by the 15 milliliters times the concentration of the dilute, which is what, 0.010. So the molarity of the Ag plus is now going to be what? 2/3 of 0.01. I would say 0.00666666. Okay, so that's the concentration now of the silver ion. So now we have to do the exact same thing for the chloride, but what's the chloride ion coming from? CaCl2, so when I put that into solution, what's it going to break up into? Ca2 plus plus 2 Cl minuses, right? So if this is equal to 0.0025 molar, what's this going to be equal to? 0.005. Okay, so that's my initial concentration of the chloride ion, because it's times 2. But it's still going to get diluted, so the Cl minus ion is going to get diluted. What ratio do I put here? How many milliliters did I start with? 5 milliliters of it, right? What did I dilute it to? 15. So it's going to be 5 over 15. But it's times this 0.005, because that was my initial concentration. So this turns out to equal 0.00167, so 1/7 molar, is my Cl minus. So that's my diluted concentration. So we had two things we had to kind of figure in there. We had to know that it broke up into the two, so we had to double the initial, but then we had to use the dilution equation. Okay? Now what do we do with those two numbers? Plug it in and solve for Q, right? So we plug in our silver, which is 0.0067 times my chloride. Now, do we need to square the chloride because of a Cl here? Is this the KSP expression I'm dealing with? No, it's this one. So even though the chloride is doubled, it's coming from this. This is the actual chloride concentration, but my KSP is this one. So I just plug it in, 0.0017, and what's that equal? That equals Q. So, is Q bigger or smaller than the given KSP? It's bigger. So what does that mean? A precipitate will form. So if we mix these two solutions together, you should expect to see the white precipitate of silver chloride. So will a precipitate form is a Q problem. And again, remember, the hardest part of a Q problem is recognizing that it's a Q problem because it never mentions the letter Q. So will a precipitate form is always, hey, I got to solve for Q.
In the course of various experiments.
Okay, turn in the white books to page 764. The white books to page 764. And I want you to do number 61B. 61B. Page 764 in the white book. Page 761B. Does anybody need a book? Got a bunch up here. You have to look up in the back on page 1126. Are we doing this problem? Yes.
So, like, have we learned how to do this pipe yet?
That's will a precipitate form. -5 × 10⁻⁵. Shoot, I forgot, what did I just say? 1.5 × 10⁻⁵. I know it's 10⁻⁵. Page 1126 is where it is. So remember, it's the dilution problem, so you got to figure out what the ion concentrations are. Then you solve for Q. Hey, y'all, you're going to get a Google Doc shared with you. Just asking about what science classes you're planning on taking next year. If you'll fill that out, they're just trying to get an idea of numbers for classes on which one's going to, you know, have enough to make and all that. I do know that they're trying to offer the Physics C2, which is electricity and magnetism. So it's going to be tough to determine whether or not there's going to be enough interest in that class.
Yeah. You need to fill that out right now.
No.
You got your AP environmental science. Got earth science.
None of y'all better be taking earth science.
So, Cameron, what are you planning to take next year?
I don't even know. I might not even have a show. Wait, no, I'm doing chemical engineering.
Yeah. What are you guys planning to take next year? You guys, are you a senior?
C1?
Both of y'all?
Do
you have any idea what you're going to take? You're a senior. One of my seniors. I was a senior. Do you know what you're going to take as far as the time? No, this is not locked in stone or anything. Just what do you think?
Probably
85.
85?
We'll put you down at the bottom. Naomi, what do you think?
That's a bigger number.
What do you lean in? What are you trying to decide?
Yeah, there we go.
Physics 1?
Reese, what's the answer?
David, what do you think you're going to take next year?
85?
Lexi?
Bio.
Anatomy. Oh, I forgot about that.
Wow.
Miss Lewis, you're very upset. Isaac, do you know what you're going to take next year?
Yeah, my mom works at home. She's
what are you leaning towards?
I know she's a great teacher.
Right.
And
you know
she's
my work there.
Really?
What do you plan to take? That's an or. That's a half. One?
Are
you done? Emma, do you know what you're playing on? Is that'll count as we have dual enrollment science? Are you a senior? No. We have dual enrollment science? For HSA or something? Do that? Because I don't think we have consensus.
But
thank you, everybody. Physics 1, probably.
Physics, no.
Okay. All right, let's refocus now. And I know that right now you're in the midst of AP Chemistry and it's very hard. And so your natural tendency is going to, don't take it, it's hard. Okay? But the reality is in the long run, especially if you're going anything medicine or engineering, that this is going to help you tremendously in college. I mean, like, if any of y'all know John Gotham, he's breezing through UAB. John Gotham, he was on the bowling team last year. He had AP Chemistry as a junior, then AP Bio as a senior, and he's just cruising. And I will tell you that Ms. Cannon is saying that those that come out of AP Chemistry going into AP Biology are doing much better than those that did not have AP Chemistry, because the chemistry part of it is very helpful. So I just encourage you to encourage the sophomores, and if you know any juniors that may be in AP Bio, to take AP Chemistry, because it is going to help. Now, one other thing I have to survey y'all on, okay? This year, they're doing two classes, two credits, the first one being a 5, the second one being a 4, unweighted for the second one. Okay? I have pretty much convinced them to go for next year, and it's not going to help you all out, but next year being one credit, still two periods, one credit, one grade, and it's weighted, 5. Okay, so is there anybody that would not have taken this class if you weren't getting 2 credits for it?
No.
So that's my point.
No, that's okay. So much better than 2.
Yeah, because now you'll divide by 6 and it won't, and so.
I would have been more likely to take it.
I don't know, I'll see if we can adjust it, but didn't you say you can just drop a class?
Yeah, but that's, I'd rather you adjust it. It'd make it a lot easier for everyone.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean,
I would have been more likely to take it if I
knew. Like,
yeah. I know. And so that was my argument yesterday, and they finally bought it. Okay?
Can you argue for us, too?
I will try to see what I can do. I'll talk to Mr. G about it now and see. No, it's just one semester just deleting those grades.
But he doesn't have any grades in the lab.
Yeah, I only have 100 per participation grade.
What did they do
last year? Last year, it was one class, one grade. Yeah. Okay, so that's good to know. There's zero. I do know of several people that did not take it because of the 4.
I figured it would be a 4 just because they're reaching it 2 credits.
Yeah. Okay, so, all right, so let's look at this one. So we're asking if a precipitate of silver sulfate will form. So that's the equilibrium expression we want to use. So it's going to be Ag2SO4 solid. And for Ks, P, and Q, any of these, we always write the equilibrium expression starting with the solid. What's this going to dissociate into?
2Ag
plus SO4 2 minus. Okay? Now, what we're going to do is we're going to be mixing. We have a beaker full of silver nitrate, and we have a beaker full of sodium sulfate? Na2SO4. The silver nitrate concentration is given as 100 milliliters of 0.05. So this is 100 milliliters of 0.050 molar, and this is 10 milliliters of 5 times 10 to the minus 2 molar, which, what's 5 times 10 to the minus 2 equal to? 5 times 10 to the minus 2, what's that equal to in decimal form?
0.05.
It's the exact same. Rather than just saying 0.05, and again, of my short-term memory, it is 10 milliliters. So it's just 0.050 molar as well. Okay? So we're going to pour that in. Y'all, please stop all the talking. We're going to pour this into that. Okay? We're going to find out then, at once we mix them, will our Q, which is going to equal Ag plus squared times SO4 2 minus, will this solubility product be greater than the given KSP? So, we have to figure out, well, what's my diluted concentrations? Now again, notice the silver is coming from silver nitrate. The sulfate is coming from the sodium sulfate. So I don't worry about the coefficients on this one when I'm trying to get my concentration. I'm just having to look here. Then notice it's a 1-to-1 and 1-to-1, so I don't have to do any doubling or any of that. So, my silver ion concentration is going to equal, silver ion concentration is going to equal, how much is it going to get diluted? What's the ratio going to be? 100 to 110.
Yep.
So what did it start with to what did it go to times the 0.050. And then my sulfate ion concentration is going to equal what over what? 10 over 110. Times the 0.050 for it. OK? Okay, so what's my diluted silver ion concentration equal to? What's this come out to? 100 over 110 times 0.05? 0.045?
Yeah.
And what about the 10 over 110? 4.5 times 10 to the minus third? Do we agree on that?
Yeah.
Which would be 0.0045 molar?
Yes.
So now what do I do? Plug it in to my K or Q problem. So Ag, 0.045, and I'm going to square that times 0.0045, and that turns out to equal 9.1 times 10 to the minus 6. So is that bigger or smaller than the given K? Smaller, so will a precipitate form? Because Q is less than KSP, no precipitate will form. Okay? So the whole idea of will a precipitate form is all about solving for Q, but it's a two-pronged problem. You got to do the dilution part, then you have to plug it in and solve for Q. Because we need to know what are the diluted concentrations. Any questions on that? I want to get to the last type of problem, then we're done with all of the problems, and we're just going to do a lab tomorrow. Then we're going to, on Friday, we'll do more practice problems. Monday, we might just go ahead and do another lab.
After the times table.
After the times table, that's right. We can do that in there. So tomorrow's is a qualitative lab. Mondays will be a quantitative lab, which will be this last type of problem.
So we don't need our lab books tomorrow?
You do not need your lab books, but you do need to dress appropriately for labs.
Take the whole time?
Probably not.
Oh, so what do we...
We'll probably just maybe work some practice problems at the end. We'll make sure we have the whole thing finished and done and turned in. Okay? It's like a 7-page handout. There's going to be a bunch of stuff you got to fill in. 20th, I believe.
So, like, not this Monday, but next?
Yeah. God forbid we go more than 2 whole weeks.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so problem number five, our last type problem, okay, of this unit, and then just realize we got 2 units left.
Woo.
Electrochemistry and acids and bases.
Yeah,
but it's still just 1 unit. It's only a chapter and a half. But now, well, you're going to be the exception. I'm getting better. I'm getting better and better. Okay. Shh. Focus. Y'all, 15 minutes. We can do it. Then I have to go pick out this year's bowling ring. So. Okay. So, the fifth and final type of problem. The fifth and final type of problem. I'm just waiting for everyone to stop all the extraneous talk and focus. Okay, so this one is, the fourth one is, will a precipitate form? This one is, which ion will precipitate first? Which substance will precipitate first when a solution contains 2 different ions?
Thank you.
Okay. It's a burette. We're going to do a titration on Monday. Okay? So if we look at, you already have the book open to page 764, okay? And you look at question number 65, and it says a solution contains 2.0 times 10 to the minus 4th molar silver and 1.5 times 10 to the minus 3rd molar lead ions. If NaI is added, will AgI or PbI2 precipitate first? So which one's going to precipitate first? So we have a solution that has Ag plus in it, and it has Pb2 plus floating around in it. They're both aqueous. And then we're going to begin adding some sodium iodide to it. Okay? So what are my two possible precipitates going to be here? If I'm putting Ag plus and NaI, which one of these is Ag plus going to want to combine with? Na plus or I minus?
I minus.
So it formed which ion? AgI. Right? So my first precipitate would be AgI solid, and it would dissociate into Ag plus plus I minus. Now the reality is, in this reaction, we're really going that way. But what we're trying to find out is, you know, what's this ion, this times this, what are these concentrations going to be? What's my other precipitate going to be? PbI2, right? Which is going to be Pb2 plus plus 2i minus. Now the KSPs are both given. The KSP of this and the KSP of this is given, are given as 2.0 times 10 to the minus 4th. No, that's the molarity. The KSP is 8.3 times 10 to the minus 17th. And this one is equal to 7.9 times 10 to the minus 9th molar. Now, just looking at the values of KSP, I tend to want to think that this one's going to precipitate first. But we have a square in there, so that kind of messes everything up. So you can't just look at the value of KSP and say, oh, this one's smaller, so it's going to precipitate first. Okay? So what we have to do is say, okay, notice I have my common ion. I need to solve. I know the KSP. I need to solve for what is the I minus concentration have to be. Which one's going to have the smaller I minus concentration in order for a precipitate to form? So I know, it tells me in the problem that the silver ion concentration is given and the Pb2 plus concentration is given. What's silver given as? Someone read it to me. Okay, and what's the Pb2 plus concentration? Okay. So I know, now in my my KSP expression, I know the value of KSP, I know the value of the silver, I know the value of the Pb2+. The one thing I don't know is the I- concentration. So what I solve for is the I- in both of them. Whichever one is smallest, as you're adding NaI to that, it's going to get to the smaller concentration first before it gets to the bigger one. Right? So whichever one needs the least amount of I minus to precipitate, that's the one that's going to precipitate first. So we just plug in here and say, okay, well, this is Ag plus, which is going to be 2.0 times 10 to the minus 4th times I minus. And this one's going to be 1.5 times 10 to the minus 3rd times I minus squared. That's a lousy 2. So solve for I minus for each one. For the top one, it's just this divided by that. 4.15 times 10 to the minus 13th. Did I do that math right? Okay, and then this one is going to be divided by 1.5 and then take the square root of it. So my I minus here times 10 to the negative what? Third? Okay, so this one is way, way smaller than this one. So it's going to take way less of this I minus to form a precipitate than it is this one. So this one is definitely going to precipitate first. Okay? Way smaller. Okay? So it's going to precipitate first. Which, and then minus 17th, minus 9. Now, the second part of this question, which it doesn't really ask, but AP tends to ask, is, and this is kind of be on our lab, we're going to have this question as well, is, okay, so this one's going to precipitate first. So we're adding this. We're going to start getting silver iodide precipitating out. But the lead is going to stay soluble. We're not going to get any lead iodide precipitating out until we get the I minus all the way up to this concentration. It's not until it gets all the way to here will the lead begin to precipitate out. This is going to precipitate first. So this is all precipitating out, precipitating out. You keep adding I minus, keep adding I minus. It's precipitating it out. But finally, the I minus is going to get to this concentration. Then the lead's going to start precipitating out. So the question is, what's the silver iodide? How much silver is left in solution when the lead begins to precipitate out? So now this time, we're going to know what the I minus concentration is. We're going to have to go backwards then and figure out, okay, well, what's the silver concentration? So for part B, we would say, all right, 8.3 times 10 to the minus 17th is going to equal, what's the silver ion concentration once the I minus reaches this and the lead begins to precipitate out? Okay? This is the I minus when Pb2 plus begins to precipitate. That's the second ion begins to precipitate. So what does silver turn out to be here? What's the Ag plus? So you just take this divided by this. .3 times 10 to the minus 17th divided by 2.29 times 10 to the minus 3rd. Times 10 to the minus 15th? 14th? 4? Minus 4? 14th. Okay. 1/4. I'll eventually get there. 10 to the minus 14th. That's not very much. Almost all of the silver is completely precipitated out. This is one way you can separate a solution. It's called selective precipitation. You're precipitating out one ion over the other. The lab that we're going to do on Monday, we're going to use selective precipitation. We're going to want to know how much chloride ion is present. Well, we're going to titrate it with silver nitrate. In chloride is going to be down in here. Okay? But we're also going to have some potassium chromate down in here. And you make silver chromate as a red precipitate. Silver chloride is a white precipitate. But silver preferentially reacts with chloride over chromate. So you're going to get the white precipitate forming. So we're going to be able to get all the chloride out. And then once almost all the chloride is gone, we'll begin reacting with the chromate, and it's going to start turning red. So it's going to go from white, 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 and then it's going to turn red. And the first faint sign of red, that's going to be our end point. So we're going to know then, okay, almost all the chloride is gone at that point. As a matter of fact, how could we get what percent Ag plus remains when Pb2 plus begins to precipitate? Well, what's my percent Ag? What's the part that's left? 3.62 times 10 to the minus 14th. What did we start with? 2.0 times 10 to the minus 4th times 100. So what percent, what fraction is left when the lead begins to precipitate out. You can see it's going to be a pretty small percent. And you multiply by 100, right? So, 8. So 1.18 times 10 to the minus 8th percent of the silver remains in solution, which is really an immeasurable amount, once the lead begins to precipitate. So you could theoretically, if you had a solution of silver and lead, you could get the silver, you could separate those two, you couldn't filter it because they're both dissolved, but you could selectively precipitate. We got 3 minutes, y'all, don't start putting up. Okay? You could selectively precipitate the silver out by adding in some sodium iodide. As you add that in, the silver is going to precipitate, silver is going to precipitate, silver is going to precipitate. None of the lead is going to precipitate out because it's KSP. It won't begin precipitating until the I minus is way, way, much, much greater. So we can selectively precipitate it out because of the difference in the KSP values, because of the difference in solubilities. So the KSP in general is nothing more than how soluble or insoluble is something. The smaller the value of KSP, the less soluble it is, the more insoluble. So we have five problems. This is probably the most useful one, this selective precipitation. So molar, to calculate the molar solubility given KSP, we just use X and X or X and 2X and solve for X. To find KSP from molar solubility, you just make sure the molar solubility that's given is in molarity, and then just plug it in and solve for KSP. If we have a common ion, well then the ion that's common comes from two things, so we're going to have X amount coming from the thing we're looking at, plus a certain other amount from a secondary source, we just add them together. If we're going to determine which one's going to precipitate first, then we just have to solve for Q. It's a dilution problem and a Q problem. So we solve for what are the diluted concentrations, plug it into Q, compare. And then lastly, which one will precipitate first? You just solve for the one ion that's being added. It's whatever's being added is what you solve for. Whichever one is smallest, that's the one that will precipitate first. Okay? So tomorrow's going to be a lab, so make a note to yourself. Justin's not here to remind you to do the remind. All you got to do is dress appropriately. You do not need your lab manual. Okay? I will probably send a remind out to make sure I remind the other class.